Gathered notebooks that comprise the book Towards a Theory of Musical Reproduction. Adorno uses the word culinary repeatedly to describe a way of listening to or playing music that he cautions against. He never really defines culinary listening or culinary playing thoroughly, at least not here, although to be honest, I didn't really read the whole book, but I did like control F search it, the PDF, for any mentions of the word culinary. And he does just kind of toss it in there as a modifier. But the culinary seems to describe a way of listening or playing that involves not being able to help oneself or taking too big of a helping, not having a sense of proportion, not distributing one's enjoyment thoughtfully throughout the work, but lavishing it too readily on any one part. It's a kind of gluttony that augments one part of the work at the expense of the whole or the idea of a whole, deforming it through one's partiality for it. In one passage from 1959, Adorno describes culinary enjoyment as an untimely quote-unquote surrender to the materiality and feel of musical sound, quote, "Highly organized music always means the presence of the non-present, i.e., recollecting and glancing ahead. And for the performer, this is always a mental and categorical function. Only one who does not simply feel music but also thinks it can feel it properly. At the same time, from the work's perspective, leaving aside the critique of mass culture, this is the argument against culinary listening and playing, quote unquote easy listening, and against any passive attitude. Whoever simply surrenders themselves falls short of whatever they are surrendering to," end quote. It's like he's saying, if you let the music fuck you up too fast and too fully, you won't have time to let it show you everything it's doing. You won't be able to let it fuck you up to its fullest extent on its own time. like the music is giving itself to you gradually, and you have to give yourself to it gradually too. You have to mentally shuffle back and forth across its shifting forms and patterns and not surrender too readily to the overwhelming enjoyment of the way any particular moment sounds and feels. To give in to the pressure of that feeling without holding back a little bit and pacing yourself would be premature and, again, almost gluttonous. I think that's what he means by culinary listening. So I'm Amalle. Thank you for coming. I'm a small white girl type of person with long hair, wearing a white t-shirt and jeans, blue jeans. I wanted to say thank you to Joey Lubitz and Gordon Hall and also Artist Space, and Jordan Lord and Tina Z and Sandra Wazaz and Patrick Koble, who's doing ASL, looking so cute. The song, the Robin song that was just playing, had a lyrics video with it that was projected behind me, and the images in the video were abstract close-ups of honey flowing and dripping over various objects like a gem, a flower, and some feathers, and the room we're in has a lot of dim, multicolored light. You guys probably already know, but there's a table with food and drinks to your left behind the columns, and you should feel free to eat and wander around and do whatever feels comfortable. There's accessible non-gendered bathrooms behind you and to the right, and there's an upstairs space I think is sort of semi-open if you, and is quieter if you want to be somewhere chiller than here. And then I wasn't sure whether to do like a content warning, but I'm going to be talking about a very fatphobic text later, and it's going to be after the Mariah Carey song, so just so you know, that's going to happen. Culinary enjoyment is something that the listener can succumb to if they get carried away. Performers are often guilty of it too, particularly according to Adorno, quote-unquote, virtuosos who feel themselves too much, quote, when the means, the flavor of their playing, becomes the end, rather than, end quote, rather than subordinating itself to the work. Tone, he writes, is much the same. As soon as it begins to relish itself, the musical context suffers. The culinary qualities are regressive, and I think he's saying they're regressive because what he's calling culinary is like the basis, like the material, the kind of first basis, the sound material that the artwork kind of rides in on. Even the music itself can fall prey to what he calls a kind of quote-unquote self-relish. Anthony Gritton describes Adorno's notion of the culinary in terms of an oscillation, quote, an oscillating connective link between performing and listening, end quote. This lush non-locality of enjoyment, its circulation through the listener, oh no, shit, that was not a joke. I actually needed to finish that sentence. the performer and the music, it circulates through the listener, the performer and the music. So, the adjective culinary also comes up in relation to music's excessive beauty. In notes after an August 1954 lecture, Adorno writes, concerning the problem of the culinary, the beautiful tone, or in 1953, concerning the B-flat major trio by Beethoven, performance by Heifetz, Feuermann, Arthur Rubinstein, quote, too beautiful. Here that means the sensual euphony of the sound eclipses the realization of the construction. Everything is smoothed out, which is funny because when we listen to Mariah Carey's Honey, they're like the part at the end where Mace is rapping, he says what we're gonna do right here is smooth it out for you. It's as though for Adorno, if the beauty is too loud, you can't hear the work itself. I'm interested in the sexual dimension of this account of surrender and resistance, matter and form. In his notes from August 1966, Adorno recounts a disagreement he had with his cousin, France, and the harpsichordist Edith Picked Axenfeld, quote, concerning the reproduction theory, the strongest argument against me came from my cousin Franz and Edith Picked, namely that one should present only the sensual appearance as the structure communicates itself. If I love a woman, I want her body, not her X-ray image. But this, as plausible arguments usually go, is pure sophistry. apologia for the pre-artistic culinary element. For the hidden structural aspect is that which lends sense. If it is not realized in the appearance, then this latter becomes mere sound material and thus senseless. I'm going to skip a little bit. The essence must appear. He's saying basically, if the girl or the music is just flesh, is just sound, if the structure or form that lends her meaning doesn't appear on her surface, or that she is just flesh or just sound if the structure doesn't appear on her surface. And his cousin and his friend are like, the deep interior skeletal structure you're hoping to feel the trace of is actually just an x-ray or a kind of belated diagnostic image without any feeling or substance. The x-ray photograph is actually Adorno's favorite shorthand for how performance can reveal the interior structure of a work, all that he calls, quote-unquote, subcutaneous within it, which, quote, otherwise lies concealed both under the menstrual notation and the sound sensory surface. The score and the sound of its performance enflesh the work, but also in this particular way of thinking about flesh, obstruct and cover its form. The thicker and more irresistible the sound or one's enjoyment of or one's appetite for it is, the more it necessarily distorts the unfolding of the work as a whole. What Adorno terms quote-unquote culinary sound thus tends to mess up the apprehension and development of aesthetic form. It threatens to circumvent the artwork's dynamic structure through a kind of premature sensory and affective gratification, an unbalanced partiality that causes one part of the work to augment itself too much and makes it swell up and deform the whole. I feel like I said that already, but... the fullness, richness, or elaboration of a tone, a passage, or a player's interpretation begins to pull away from the overall shape of the work, which it was meant to support and gradually disclose. Am I going too fast? A little bit too fast. Slow down. Okay, thank you. The culinary thus describes a kind of deformative pressure that commingled need, pleasure, and enjoyment bring to bear on form, performance, and aesthetic judgment. It's like that with actual food as well. You don't just like its form, you also need it materially and nutritionally. But you also still like it, and in the sensory and aesthetic experience of its flavor, your enjoyment and your need for it can't be teased apart. Oh, oh, honey, get me hooked on you.
Yeah. you on fire. All the world, we won't stop. So Mariah, take us higher.
Break down. Now what we gonna do right here is we gonna smooth it out. Come on. MC. And she won't stop.
Like a lyrics video with a yellow background and a kind of like Comic Sans, like silly kind of font. Partly this all started because I got really upset about Cruel Optimism, which is a book by Lauren Berlant that came out in 2011. I'm still mad about. Berlant is an influential queer theorist who became famous in the 90s, or as famous as an academic could be, at least, for making it okay and cool to seriously consider ordinary feelings and regular sentimentality and other things like that, that I guess at some point in the past in some academic circles had been considered unrigorous or apolitical to write about in that way. Berlant's work was also important to me personally. I remember being in Labyrinth Books in 1999 or 2000 with Timothy, my first queer partner, senior year of high school. Still love him so much. And sitting on the floor in the gay section, reading coffee table books with portrait photos of drag kings. Labyrinth was also where I bought Berlant's 1997 book, The Queen of America Goes to Washington City, because there was a chapter about fetal citizenship, a phrase which seemed so intensely satisfying and glamorous to me for some reason at the time. Shortly after that, I stole an anthology Berlant edited called Intimacies from the library. It was a book, but also it was a special issue of a journal, and I didn't know that an academic journal could be like that, like fun and gay, but still also kind of severe and about sex, or that a book could have chapters written by different authors, as if it were an actual candy store or a variety pack or a rare compilation album, or as if there were a mini gay bookstore within the book itself. I didn't really mean to steal it, but I knew immediately that I wouldn't want to give it back, and I didn't know where I could buy one. And I basically decided at that point that I wanted to be a gay academic when I grew up. So. It's nothing to celebrate, really. By the time Cruel Optimism came out, 10 years later, I was a graduate student and therefore possibly a victim of the phenomenon of cruel optimism that the book's title describes, which is basically when what you think you want or what you do want hurts you, or to use her language, quote, is an obstacle to your flourishing. In particular, I got really upset about chapter 3, which is on the so-called obesity epidemic. It's also the only chapter that's not about like a text or like a art object or whatever. And Kyla was on a Tompkins points out. And it's a reprint of her 2007 essay, the same name. And the title of that chapter in the essay is, quote, Slow Death, Sovereignty, Obesity, Lateral Agency. And I should say here also, in case it's not clear, that I'm using the word obesity not interchangeably with fatness, which I think is how she's using, well, whatever. Obesity is a medicalizing slur which names fatness and fat people as a pathology to be eradicated. Berlant's way of thinking about eating and its relationship to fatness and debility is part of her broader interest in the way that our attachments harm us or disappoint the promise of their fulfillment. Attachment is basically another word for dependency, but also dependency that's shot through with fantasy, and those are essentially my two favorite things. One of Berlant's supposed interventions in slow death is the term, quote, lateral agency, which is meant to render fatness not an individual moral problem, sort of, but a social one. Epidemic fatness, for her, is an interesting object for her account of what she calls distributed causality, because it is at once understood to be overdetermined by social and economic causes, and by the same token, indeterminate. In other words, even though fatness, like, for example, pregnancy, is taken as evidence of a behavior and imagined as a kind of self-evident potential effect, more or less, of desire and pleasure, no one really knows what causes it, or rather, no one knows how to make people stop being fat. The obesity epidemic, writes Berlant, quote, is also a way of talking about the destruction of life, of bodies, imaginaries, and environments by and under contemporary regimes of capital, end quote. Epidemiology, the medicalized or social scientific study of how something becomes widely contagious, offers Berlant a way into what, for her, is a troubling concomitance of growth and decay on the scale of populations. Quote, the phrase slow death, this is like the first paragraph of the essay, refers to the physical wearing out of a population and the deterioration of people in that population that is very nearly a defining condition of their experience and historical existence. It, the phrase slow death, takes as its point of departure David Harvey's polemical observation that under capitalism, sickness is defined as the inability to work. This powerful observation about the rationalization of health is an important part of the story, but it is not the whole story either. Through the space opened up by this concept, I, Lauren Berlant, offer a development in the ways we conceptualize contemporary historical experience, especially where life building and the attrition of human life are indistinguishable, and where it is hard to distinguish modes of incoherence, distractedness, and habituation from deliberate and deliberative activity, as they are all involved in the reproduction of predictable life. How am I doing with like reading speed? Does it feel okay, or should I slow down a little bit? It's okay, thank you. Eating is interesting to Berlant because it's a thing you do on purpose, but also habitually, without really thinking, and where small-scale feelings and larger-scale effects have an ambiguously causal relationship. Part of the conceptual knot she claims to discover is that eating, admittedly, quote, necessary to existence, part of the care of the self, the reproduction of life, end quote, and the evident cause of growth, is, in an apparent paradox, deemed by her and her medico-sociological bibliography to be debilitating. So I am particularly interested in Berlant's remark about the difficulty of establishing a clear distinction between decay and growth. Fatness is where, quote, life building and the attrition or decay of human life are indistinguishable. Food, like, makes you live and it makes you die. It can be nutritive, an intoxicant, a poison, or whatever. In a pretty direct way, I actually agree with her that life is debility and vice versa. Although my feelings about life, death, debility, and fatness are pretty much the exact opposite of hers. If fatness for her represents a confluence of growth and decay on a personal level and a social one, oh, I didn't finish that sentence. Oh, epidemic fatness is a social problem, a problem with sociality itself. In other words, it's not so much slow death that bothers Berlant, or at least not death in the sense of finitude. It's actually the promiscuous reproductivity of fatness and debility which is of concern to her. The obesity epidemic is a contagion that moves through families, friends, and social life, which is why so-called childhood obesity is the most upsetting to her, and other people, I guess. What Berlant discovers as a problem, the blur of social reproduction, pleasure, need, and debility, I would describe as quite obviously a profound aesthetic and social resource. If we were to accept the non-opposition of life and death as a precept, slow death would, I guess, be a technically accurate, if rude, way of describing life as a mode of progressive dependency. or the growing decay of individual figures, and as with any epidemic or contagion, of individuation itself, because people have to take care of one another. Berlant's suspicion of the culinary, like Adorno's, is concerned with when to surrender to enjoyment and need, the timing required in order to maintain the proper form and figure. Diet conjoins austerity to futurity, and fatness is seen as evidence of a failure to budget, resulting in a quote-unquote premature curtailment of life. Quote, paradoxically, of course, at least during this phase of capital, there's less of a future when one eats without an orientation toward it. Like, whatever. Honestly. In Berlant's account, dietary frugality must accrue as investment or incur bad, fatally reproductive debt. However, it's not, as she claims, the curtailment of a future that troubles Berlant, but rather the form of debility's specific futurity and the specific futurity of disabled fatness, its reproductivity, its contagion, its spread and its movement, its heritability and its sociability, the way it extends itself through enjoyment and need. So this is a video still of Mariah Carey from the music video for Honey. She's looking back over her shoulder with her hair flowing, and there's green water in the background, and the subtitle at the bottom of the image reads, "Oh baby, I've got a dependency." Honey is kind of similar to a lot of love songs in that it's about dependency, in this case a kind of chemical dependency. We're gonna listen to it a couple more times, or part of it. That was the same lyrics video as before with the yellow background. So I listened to Honey a lot in the car this summer and also still in a particularly culinary way. And what I mean by that is exactly what Adorno means, which is the kind of expressive distension of meaning and form through interpretive augmentation. In the song, Honey isn't just a food, but an addictive intoxicant, one that induces the slurring together of desire, pleasure, and need, blurring together whose need is whose. One of the kinds of intoxicated slurring I'm thinking about is the misprision of pop lyrics, like when people think "Hey Jude" is "Hey Dude" or other things like that. Culinary enjoyment is about the way that vocals can expressively thicken meaning, but also about the way that the sensual or emotional experience of the listener can also distort things. Sometimes the more you like a song, the more you mishear the words and get attached to the version that you made up, or didn't exactly make up, but allowed to emerge from the way the singer's performance of being overcome or intoxicated, their words giving way to a kind of expressive sonic materiality, blurs together with your own desire. The circulation between a performance distended by or surrendered to an excessive desire and enjoyment and the listener's experience of that surrender. Oh, that also wasn't a full sentence. It's okay. In particular, I really like the way that the word honey seems to decay into the phrase "I need" at the end of the track. And I can't sing this, but I can play the, yeah.
Breakdown. Yeah. Now what we gonna do right here? Is we gonna smooth it out. Come on. MC. And she won't stop.
listen to the background vocals. Also, when I was thanking people before, I forgot to thank Jackson, who's doing the soundboard, and thank you, Jackson, because it's really nice. I appreciate it a lot. Okay. So, wait, where did I? Okay. I lost my spot. Okay. So, yeah, so I guess I'm interested in that way that she's saying, like, I need and honey, and you kind of can't tell the difference between the two things. It sort of sounds like saying I need almost. Sexual need is an interesting thing because it demonstrates a way in which need and provision, dependency and care, are indistinguishable. It's a case in which a need can be met by being redoubled and combined with someone else's, such that the more need you have, the more you have. The phrases, I need honey, I need need, layer onto one another, devolving and decaying into a kind of surplus pile. The slurring isn't just an expressive function, a function of the virtuoso or whatever, feeling herself, but also the slur between whether she got carried away by that moment or whether you did as the listener. The last thing I wanted to say, oh yeah, sorry, oh yeah, we're getting to that, okay. I'm going to visually describe that in a second. Okay. The last thing I wanted to say was if, according to Berlant, thickness leads to debility or disability, we could also say inversely, disability produces the kind of thickness that we like. What I mean by that is the way that when everyone is contributing their need, the variety of their needs, it makes the party thicker and lusher and noisier. We could think about this in terms of the literal multiple ways of entering or being in an actual space, or on the level of an image, a text, an artwork, a song, the layering of access, like captioning, for example, that becomes a kind of distracting augmentation or enrichment. And so then we have this meme showing a very swole wrestler in a silky blue singlet standing with their hands on their hips, and their chest is labeled movie, and their crotch is labeled subtitles. And there's a shorter figure labeled me on their right, who's talking to the wrestler, but looking down wistfully at the wrestler's crotch, labeled subtitles. Access, as in captions, for example, is sometimes regarded as a kind of ungainly addition to an artwork or a film, meant to make up for a perceptual supposed deficit on the part of disabled people. It may be a translation, as in a displacement, but it's also an addition, which makes the form bulkier. And that bulkiness violates the imagined elegance and completeness of an artwork's form or concept. So when Jordan, whose work deals a lot with captioning, and whose work has been really like helpful for me in thinking about this, was helping me write this, they described captioning as, quote, an addition that's also a subtraction. In other words, access is not the kind of impartial, policy-driven equality that it is sometimes purported to be, but a way of adding more partiality, more moving parts. It is necessarily choral. Access is often bemoaned as burdensome standardization, but it's actually always improvisatory, because improvisation is also this operation of taking a quote-unquote given artwork or pattern and elaborating it, and access is a similar distension, bulking up or swelling of the artwork. It is necessary, oh, I already said that, it's necessarily choral. What's understood as a decay or delay of the artwork is also its increase or growth. It makes the artwork fatter, thicker, slower, and richer. It happens a lot with CART, or live captioning, or automatic captions on YouTube, for example. That gain, and Tina added to this, and grain, is the thickness that you could fall in love with, because it involves you in the means of getting around or communicability and the poetry or choreography of that means. That thickness slows you down. Pretty much every love song and every sex song are about disability and dependency. Maybe not every single one, but like literally most of them if you listen to them. Call the doctor, don't call the doctor. I get so weak in the knees, I can hardly speak. And then how people treat that debt of love and need is pretty much everything.
My pride. Thank you, Amal. Thank you, Aria. Thank you all for coming. Feel free to hang out. We have the space for a little bit more time, so feel free to chill. Thanks. Thank you, Patrick.